Good evening. Good afternoon. My name is Kelly. I'm an alcoholic. And one thing I want to assure you, okay, because I've been told 16 times by Dick, okay, you will be out of here before the game today. I was born in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, in June 23rd, 1942. I turned 75 years old in June. And this weekend, I am celebrating 35 years of sobriety right here. And I'll tell you what, I'm so intimidated by following these great speakers, starting off with my homegirl, and then Clancy, and then the two speakers this morning. I mean, what an act to follow, right? Oh, I'm like this up here. And one thing, when Mari was up here, I don't know if I should tell you this or not. Go on. Okay. I'm gonna tell you about this. I hadn't thought about this for a long time, okay? In fact, I'd forgotten all about it. And when Mari was up here talking this morning, all of a sudden, you know how it does? The light bulb goes on in your head. And I thought, oh my God, I forgot all about that. That happened when I was new. What had happened was that they kept telling me, you gotta do your fourth and fifth step. You got to do your fourth and fifth step. Well, I wasn't going to do my fifth step with any of all y'all, okay? Because it was so horrible, okay? The person I had become was so horrible, and I was laden with guilt and shame. I'm a person who cannot get sober, okay? Because of the guilt and the shame. So what I did was I thought, okay, I'm going to go out of town, right? I'm going to find a priest. Somebody kind of young that really doesn't know the ropes yet, you know? And then I'm going to tell him, now I don't want to get in the box with you, okay? Okay, I want to eyeball. I just want to have a talk with you. So anyway, I found this priest, right? His name is Father Benjamin, out in Reseda, California, okay? And I sat there eyeball to eyeball with him, and I just told him everything. And I said, now, Father, please, are you going to give me penance? I thought, excommunication, please, no. Penance, you know. And he sat there and he looked at me. And what I didn't know, okay, his mother was in Alcoholics Anonymous. I didn't know this. So anyway, he says, yeah, I'm going to give you penance. And I thought, oh my goodness, he's going to give me, like, you know, Hail Marys and Our Fathers and a bunch of rosaries to do. And of course he's going to say, go put money in the poor box, you know, and for you big bucks in the poor box. But he just took a breath and he looked at me and he says, Kelly, I'm going to give you penance. Here it is. And I was ready. He says, go to AA for the rest of your life. Anyway, after that, I did do a proper fifth step with my sponsor. And at that time, what my sponsor would do is he would have someone like me go with him whenever he went to speak. And he'd say, okay, bring your fourth step and bring a flashlight. And I said, bring him fourth step and a flashlight. Yeah. So while he was driving down to Oceanside, I had the flashlight and I was reading my fourth step to him. And I thought, oh, he's going to say, oh, Kelly, you're just one of the finest people in the world. Look how far you've come. That wasn't the case. Whenever we got back up to Venice, California, and I got out of the car, he said, Kelly. I said, what? He says, you are the most self-obsessed human being I've ever met in my life, kid. And he says, your big character defect is you're judgmental. He says, you're like a person who's laying in the gutter looking down on other people. He says, do you realize you're a patient in these rooms, huh? Do you realize that? You're a patient in these rooms. He says, how dare you judge another human being in a meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous? Oh, and I was like, oh my gosh. He says, yeah. He says, when a speaker is up there speaking, he says, you listen to the message. You don't stand around and judge the messenger. When you're in a meeting and you're sharing, and it's a sharing meeting, he says, you listen to the message. God is trying to give you a message. And he says, that character defect of judgment, he says, it's going to run you right out the door. And he says, as bad an alcoholic as you are, you need to keep your seat in a meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous. Boom! So, and then later on in life, I come across Sandy. And whenever I moved to Florida, come across Sandy. And Sandy B. was really great. And before he passed away, he had called me over and he says, Kelly, he says, it's real important that you stick with the winners. And I said, the winners? He says, yeah, don't you know what the winners are in AA? I says, no, but I want to be one. He goes, well, a winner in Alcoholics Anonymous is the least disturbed person in a meeting. Oh, Sandy, that's great. He goes, yeah. He says, whenever you're in judgment with somebody, you're disturbed. You're disturbed. He says, so stay out of judgment of people. Second time I hear this, right? And he says, stay undisturbed and you will be a winner. And boy, I wish that from Sandy Beach's lips to your ears. I wish that all for all y'all. Thank you, I'm done. No. But anyway, after doing the fifth step and everything, and after getting these messages, every morning I get up, and the first thing I do is I do the third step prayer and the seventh step prayer. This is really something. The seventh step prayer goes like this. I'm sure you all know. My Creator, I am now willing that you should have all of me, good and bad. Oh my gosh. And I'm like, good and bad? So I asked somebody, one of the old wise people around, I said, what is this good and bad? Well, Kelly, your brain, way it's functioning and diseased, you don't know what's good and what's bad. See, you guys, when I was out there on the streets, or I was out there on L.A. Skid Row, okay, I had survival skills. I survived the streets, you know? I survived those streets. So I'm not going to give up my survival skills. And my sponsor was calling them character defects. Lying, cheating, stealing, being manipulative. I mean, I survived on the streets like that. You can't take that away from me. What am I going to do? I'll die. So anyway, I don't know what are good character defects, what are bad character defects. So they said, you've got to give it all to God, good and bad. Then God will give you back the good things that he wants you to use today, just for today, because it's a one-day reprieve. And then it goes on and it says, I pray that you, God, now remove from me every defect of character which stands in the way of my usefulness to you and my fellows. I had separated myself so much from the human race. I was shut down. I was shut so far down. I could sit in a meeting with somebody really giving a great message, and I was so into my own head and so shut down, I didn't hear a thing. And I would walk out of that meeting feeling more alone than when I walked into the meeting. Because when you shut down like I shut down and you're all alone, you're not in contact. You're separated from God and separated from people. And Chuck Chamberlain used to talk about that our separation from God and other human beings is one of our grossest character defects. See, here's the thing, okay? I was all concerned about, how do I look? Stuff. Oh my God, do I have the right car? Do I have the right clothes on? Do I have the right this, the right that? Am I skinny enough? You know, is my hair done right? You know, stuff. How do I look? Me, 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 me. And then it got down to this seven-step prayer, which is going to be also talked about in the 11th step, is that what is starving to death is this soul inside of me. My soul is starving to death. I've got to feed the soul now. And if I feed the soul, guess what? Everything else will drop in line. And that's the truth. And then it says, it goes on, it says, grant me strength. I'm a weak person. I am weak. And I thank God I'm weak, because I found strength in my weakness. Because I've seen some people go along, and I've seen them, and they are strong people. They don't need God. I'm a weak person. I need God. Thank you, God, that I'm weak. Grant me strength, and God is my strength today, as I go out from here to do your bidding, not Kelly's bidding, your bidding. So as I say, I was born in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Go Steelers! I wanted to say that in here. I just had to. You know, I had to. Anyway, my mother and father got married very young, and I come from an Irish Catholic family. I know none of all y'all are from Irish Catholic families, but I come from Catholic. Let me tell you, yeah, I come from Catholic. I've got aunts in my family that wore their starches for 60 plus years of the Notre Dame order, and nobody gets a divorce in our family, okay? People in I come from good stock, you guys. My family wants you to know I come from good stock. And I was raised right. In the day when I was raised to be somebody's mother and somebody's wife, and that's what I was raised to do. The men went off and they went across town and they went to work. The men in my family were steel workers. Okay, they were steel workers. And they went to work. They worked hard. They drank hard. And here's what they drank in Pittsburgh, okay? You probably, none of you have heard of this. They drank what was called Boilermakers. What it is, it's a shot with a beer back. And on payday, that's what they drank. And then whenever their money ran out, they drank beer. And I grew up in that family. And what had happened, okay, when I was young, what happened was my mother, she sewed parachutes across town, because my dad went to Guadalcanal, and my mother stayed home and she was sewing these parachutes. Well, my mother liked to sing. And my mother was really good looking, okay? She was really a good looking lady. And so after she got off of work at night, she'd go to these bars and she'd get up and sing. And some people really took a liking to her and they said, gee, we'd like to send you to Vegas and then out to California. And she thought that she was going to be a movie star. And so what she did was she divorced my dad and dumped me with my grandmother, okay? Now, here I am, I'm sitting in the kitchen, and my aunts and my grandmother, they're sitting around the kitchen table, and what they're doing in whispers is talking about my mother in hushed tones and whispers. And I'm sitting there, and the more they talk about her, the more I shut down, the more I shut down, the more I shut down, because I adored my mother. I absolutely adored my mother. And then all of a sudden I realized she's not coming back for me. My mother's not coming back for me. And I waited and I waited and she didn't come back for me. And so one day I got up and I went and I sat at that table. And I started badmouthing my mother too, to fit in with that. And you know, you guys, this is not what makes me an alcoholic, but what happened inside of me, it just tore me apart. Because I loved her. But I had to betray her in order to fit in. And shutting down, I was real strange in school, okay? Very strange. And whenever I got to be a teenager, Then mom came back. She had met this guy, and she came back and got me, and they took me to California. Oh, my goodness. I was so glad to get out of Pittsburgh because I knew Pittsburgh was my problem. I needed a drink long before I ever took a drink, okay? So we go to California, and mom was on a set one day, and she had taken me with her to this set. And here I was, pudgy, not really good looking or anything, not cute or anything. And there's my mom up there, and she's glamorous. And this lady's there with her, and she goes, "Oh, who's that little girl over there?" And I jump up and I go, "This is my mama." And the lady looks, she goes, "Oh my gosh." And I just went dead inside. And after that, my mother put me on a diet, tried to get me, you know, tried to get me looking like something. And I lost some weight, and I was in school, and I was in high school. And one day in high school, okay, this guy comes on campus, and he had been in the Marines. He comes on campus in his uniform, blonde hair, blue eyes. He dated one of the cheerleaders at school. And I looked at him, and I'll tell you what, you guys, instantly I fell in love. And for some reason, he came over to me, and he says, "Hey, do you like to dance?" I looked up at him, I go, "I'm a dancing fool." I'd never danced in my life. He said, "You want to go out dancing?" I go, "Yeah." He said, "Great." So he takes me out to go dancing, and he takes me to a bar. If you don't remember your first drink, I've heard you maybe haven't had it yet. So anyway, he takes me to this bar, sits me down at the end of the bar, okay? So anyway, I'm sitting there, and I look around at all the people, and they seem to be squinting at me and then whispering, and I know they don't like me. And all of a sudden, here comes this chimney glass with rum and Coca-Cola in it. And anyway, it looked really good. It had a straw in it, and I took a drink of it. Oh, it was so warm and good, and I drank it right down. And then I looked up, and the people seemed to be smiling at me. And then another drink appeared, and I drank that one right down, and I looked up, and I looked around, and I thought, these people like me. And then I drank the other drink, and I said, I love these people. You guys, I came up with BFF long before any of you youngins did. I got up, and I walked around that bar, hugging people, saying, I love you, and we're going to be best friends forever. And that night, man, I danced. Let me tell you, I danced. I taught them some new steps. Baby, I was a dancing fool. And that night, for the first time, I had sex. Yeah. And I got pregnant. Yeah, I remember my first drink. And this guy was, if any of you have been in the Marines, you know what a BAM is, right? And I'm not allowed to swear up here, but bad Marine, you know. And he stepped up to the plate. Now, I stepped up to the plate. He played baseball too. anyway, all my cousins, okay, had these Catholic weddings, you know, with the white dress, with a long train, with the veil, and the proud papa marching her down the aisle to give her to the, you know, the groom, the anxiously awaiting groom and lust, you know, waiting for her down there. And that's how my cousins got married. Pete and I, we went to Las Vegas. We got married at the Little White Chapel. Yeah. And anyway, we both drank. Both of us drank. And we had normal drinking type marriage like we saw in the movies yesterday, except there were no Al-Anons in our home. And anyway... My daughter Tracy was born. Oh, let me tell you something. When I held her in my arms, I held that little baby girl in my arms, and I had never felt so much love in my life. And I looked at her and I said, Tracy, you're never going to want for nothing. You're never going to want for a thing. Mommy and Daddy are here, and I meant it. And because I'm Catholic, okay, and I don't quite understand a lot of things, I got pregnant right away again. Yeah. And when I was 6 and a half months pregnant with my son, I was in our little apartment and had my daughter on my hip. You know how we hold our little girls. You know, Anita, you know how you held Amanda. You know, you hold her on your hip, you know. And we held our children on our hip. And I was pregnant, Nat, and I was going around doing stuff. And all of a sudden, on the door, I hear, and it sounded like somebody with a stick banging on the door. So I rush over right away, and I open it up, and it's two Los Angeles sheriffs standing there, and they weren't smiling. And they took a look at me and my condition, and they said, can we come in, and will you sit down? And I looked at them, and I said, whatever it is, tell me right now. They said, well, there was a fatal car accident, and your husband was killed. And at that moment, one of the sheriffs grabbed my daughter, and I felt myself falling to the floor and just felt like I went into a puddle. And when my son was born, I went to the hospital. And there was these babysitters, okay, that used to babysit for us. Really a beautiful family. They had seven children of their own, you know. Seven children of their own. And anyway, I go in the hospital, and they said, we'll take your daughter, and we'll take care of her while you're in the hospital. And I trusted these people, you know. And then whenever my little boy was born, Tiny Tim was born, they showed up at the hospital. All of them, all nine of them showed up at the hospital. Now, these people were what was called Pentecostals. And I wasn't familiar with what Pentecostals do, you know. And it was a little bit different from Catholicism, let me tell you. It was a friggin' shock, okay? And they came to the hospital and they says, we want you and your son to come and stay at our home. And so anyway, Tim and I, we went to the house, and a friend of mine calls, and she says, you've been through so much. She says, you want to get away? I'm a runner, you know. You tell me road trip, I'm there, you know. I'm a runner. And I said, oh, my God, yeah, I want to get away. She says, great. She said, I'm going to Las Vegas. Come on, hop in the car. We're going to Vegas. Well, we went to Vegas, okay, and you know, well, what we do in Vegas stays in Vegas, but most of you have been there, okay? I can tell, okay? And anyway, I didn't come back for 14 months. And by the time I came back, these people had taken custody of my children. And boy, I'll tell you, I went out drinking. And I drank and I drank and I drank. And what I would do is I felt such guilt and remorse. The guilt and remorse was just killing me, because a good Catholic woman that was raised to be somebody's wife and somebody's mother, and now I didn't have a husband, and I couldn't even be a mother to my children. I couldn't even do it, because every time I took a drink, the drink took everything away from me that was a woman, everything away from me that was a wife, everything away from me that was a mother. Took everything from me, and I couldn't stop drinking. But what I would do is I would go over their house at like 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning with the man du jour, and I would want to see my children. And these people would get up in the middle of the night, and I demand to see my children. So one night I decide, I'm going to go, and with my man du jour, I'm going to say, when the children come out, say that you want to hold, you know, my son, and I want to hold my daughter, and then as soon as we have the kids in our arms, we're going to run like a son of a gun, and we're taking those kids back. And I did. I went over there, and I was holding my daughter in my arms, and he had my son, and I looked at him, and just about the time that I did that, these people, they were big people, okay? They saw what I was going to do, and they reached out, and they tore my son out of this man's arms. And then the woman came to me, and she put her arms around my daughter, and she tore my daughter out of my arms. And I'll never forget that feeling of having my daughter torn from me. But you know, you guys, there was something still good deep down inside of me. There was something that was right. It was right, and it was clear way down inside of me. And I knew that these good people were the right people to take care of my children. And I turned around and I walked away. And every time that I'd sober up, I'd go looking for those children. I'd go to malls and I'd look for kids that were my children's age, thinking, could they be mine? Could they be my children? And anyway, I drank, okay, enough of that. I drank in country western bars, okay? I love country western bars. I absolutely love them. And I used to wear a costume whenever I went to country western bars, okay? See, I'm from Southern California, so whenever you go out drinking, you got to look like a movie star, right? So anyway, I had these three little styrofoam heads. One of them had a black wig, one a red wig, and one a blonde wig. And I love this big blonde wig, right? So I dressed up with my miniskirt on. I had a spandex black miniskirt. I know all of you are too young to know what a miniskirt is, but I had a spandex miniskirt, and I wore black stockings because they made my legs look good. You know what I mean? And I wore stiletto heels, so whenever I trolled that bar, baby, I would look good. I was styling, okay? You hear me? I was styling. Yeah. And anyway, I put on this big blonde wig, and I put it on with these long bobby pins, because I wanted that wig to look real in the morning, too. And in the day, people were wearing little false eyelashes. And I thought, boy, if one pair of false eyelashes would make them look good, I'm going to get me four pairs of false eyelashes. And the way you put these on, Tim, put them on with a big tube of surgical glue, okay? Yeah, okay. Big tube of surgical glue, and I put these four eyelashes on so that they would look real in the morning, too. You know? And I would go out, and I would sit at... I drank at a place called the Chit Chat in Bell Gardens. I drank in a neighborhood called the Hood. And I'd sit there. Now, you walk in the Chit Chat, and there's this big mahogany bar. And behind the mahogany bar are these mirrors. And I had my bar stool. And let me tell you something. When I got on that bar stool, I felt at home. I could have sat on that bar stool forever. And I would stare at the one I loved the most in life. And as the night went on, I'd get younger. I'd get skinnier. I'd get prettier. And I'd always look for that cowboy to walk in that door. And hopefully, I don't know where Steve is, but hopefully he had a nice big Cadillac, because I loved Cadillacs, you know. So one night I'm sitting in the bar, and anyway, he's not walking in the bar that night. I'm sitting there, and I'm drinking, and it gets to be 20 till 2, and they call last call. So I ordered my favorite drink. My favorite drink at the time was tequila gold. And after I had about quite a few of them, just shooting the tequila gold, like we used to do our drinks, shooting the tequila gold, I was biting my hand and licking the lime. And that should have been a clue. Now, whenever I left the Chit Chat, I only had to go like two blocks home to go home, okay? And the beach is way far away, okay? Bell Gardens is way, way past central Los Angeles. And anyway, that night I got in the car to go two blocks home. And the next thing I know, the sun is coming up. Uh-huh. And the sun is coming up, and I'm driving along Pacific Coast Highway. And I'm like, oh my gosh, where in the heck am I? It was the first time I'd ever had a blackout. And I have had many, many, many since then, but this was the first time. So anyway, I come out of this blackout, and I'm looking around, and I see this guy in a corner, and he's holding up a sign, "Welcome to Laguna Beach." I still don't know how I got there, but something must have happened in that car, because one of my stiletto heels had kind of broken off, and it was stuck in the floorboard of the car. And then the other one was wobbly, and I had runs up and down those black nylons. And I had this chalky white skin, you know, because I'm white, you know. Chalky white skin, yeah. Skin showing through. And I'll tell you what, white skin in Laguna Beach is not a good look in the summertime, okay? And it was in July, and it was already 84 degrees outside. And I pulled over to the side of the road. I pulled over on the sand, and I needed to think about this for a while. I needed to think about this. So I laid down across the front seat of the car, and the sun's blazing in, you know. So I wanted to black out the sun, and I put my arm over my eyes and laid there and thought about things. And I guess I went into this this alcoholic nightmare. And what it was my grandmother. And my grandmother was giving me, and Susan doesn't like me to call it this, but oh well, the Al-Anon salute. And she was going, "If you turn out like your mother, God is going to strike you deaf, dumb, and blind." And with that, I came out of this, you know, this panic-stricken nightmare. And you guys, I was blind. I couldn't see a thing. And I thought, my gosh, now I know what's the matter with me. My grandmother was a witch, and she put a spell on me. And I got out of the car. I got out of the car. And I guess I must have stepped on a few of the hard bodies that had started assembling there. And they weren't real happy with me. And I go, "I'm blind. I'm blind. I can't see. I'm blind." And then I heard footsteps running. So I started running. And with the one heel off and everything, I was kind of wobbly whenever I was running. All of a sudden, my wig leaps off of my head. But luckily, I had it secured by that long bobby pin, so it just kind of bounced along beside me on the beach. And then this guy tackles me, and I go, "Oh my God, I've been tackled by a football player. I must have made the team, you know." And he says, "Calm down. Same thing happened to my girlfriend. She's a cheerleader." I go, "I have. I've made the team. I'm never going back to Bell Gardens. I'm going to stay here with my newfound friends. They're going to take me from bar to bar, say, 'This is Kelly. She's blind. Let's buy her a drink.'" That's not what happened. He sits me down on the sand. He takes this one thumb, okay, puts it on my upper eyelid, takes another thumb, puts it on my lower eyelid, and then he very gently pulls my eyelids apart. And I guess what had happened... was that surgical glue had melted and stuck both my eyes together. And I just wanted to be a diva. So anyway, fast forward my last drink. I was drinking in a bar in Downey, shooting hurricanes. I know nobody else in this room ever shot hurricanes. Yeah, you did, I know. We would have drank together. You know that. Yeah, we would have drank together. Anyway, and then I don't know how this happened, but the police woke me up at the crack of 3:20 in the afternoon. I had nodded off in the parking lot of this bar, you know. And anyway, they told me, they says, We don't want Skid Row derelict females in our town of Downey. And they took me and they put me in jail. It was the end of November. And in the end of November, let me tell you something, those jails in Downey were like they had ice water running through the walls. They were freezing cold. And any of you who have been in jail, you know what I'm talking about. It is cold in there. And they took me and they put me in this cell and they slammed this aluminum door shut. And whenever they did, I realized that they had mistakenly locked me up with another person. And this lady was crazy. She looked, oh my God, hideous. She had hair sticking out all over the place. She had this big round red face, the craziest eyes I've ever seen in my life. And I thought, I'm going to keep my eye on her. And I keep yelling for the sheriff, you've locked me up with a crazy lady. You've locked me up with a crazy lady. Please come and get me. Come and get me. And he wasn't coming to get me. And they had told me, they said, what we're going to do with you is tomorrow we're going to transport you down to 4th and Los Angeles Street. Anybody know where that is? There you go. You know where it's at. And it was the old Midnight Mission. And we're going to put you out, and we never want to see you in this town at Downey again. And so I knew, you know, where I was going to go and everything. And anyway, what happened was, you know, here I am panicked with this woman in my cell. And then all of a sudden I look up, and I realize it's me looking at a reflection of me in that aluminum door, that moment of clarity, and I saw what I had become. And I had remembered myself as that cute girl in the blonde wig, and look what I had become. And I fell on my knees right then. And I don't know if the prayer ever got out of there, but I fell on my knees. And I begged God to take me home. I can't make it on this earth. Take me home. And then all of a sudden I thought, gee, I'm 40 years old. Maybe he's not going to take me home. So I bargained with him. I said, look, I says, if you get me out of this one, you know, I'll do anything you want me to do. Just show me the way out. And anyway, the jailer came in. They left me out OR. They didn't take me down to LA. They left me out OR. I'm embarrassed to tell you, okay? I went straight to a bar. They wouldn't serve me in the bar. They said, we're having a big celebration that we're getting ready for, and you're not welcome here. And then the guy kind of looked at me, and he goes, would you like a bowl of soup? Yeah, I'd love a bowl of soup. And anyway, it was lentil soup with little carrots floating around. I'll never forget it. And I sat there, and he says, call somebody to come and get you. You can't stay here. And I didn't have any money, and he put money on the bar. And I had a lot of pride. I grabbed the money. Had a lot of pride. That day, there was nobody that would accept a collect call from Kelly. On that day, there was no family member that wanted anything to do with Kelly. I had absolutely no friends. There was nobody on this earth. I was separated from every human being on this earth on that day. But like I said, I had a lot of pride. I grabbed the money, turned around, and there was, like everybody's talked about, one of those, you know, pay phones on the wall. And in those days, they had live 411 operators, so I knew that if I went up there and I dialed 411, that I'd get a live operator, and then I'd talk to her, and they'd think that I called somebody, and then I could go back and sit forever lying to them, telling them, oh, yeah, somebody's coming to pick me up. Yeah, somebody really loves me, coming to pick me up. So I go up to this payphone, okay? When I walk up there, there's this little card on the right-hand side. And the card says, I'll never forget it, if you think you have a problem with alcohol, call this number. Wow. And it was the South Bay Central Office. And a lady by the name of Helen answered the phone. And, wow. And she says, have you had a drink yet today? I said, that's why I'm calling you. They won't serve me. She said, good. I said, good. I've got a problem with alcohol. I can't get any. She said, well, you might be able to make it to your first meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous. She said, there'll be people there waiting for you. They're going to be so happy to see you. Well, I hadn't had anybody happy to see me come anywhere. I said, really? She said, yeah. She says, where are you at? I said, well, I'm in a bar, you know. She says, if you leave there right now, you might be able to make it there by the time the meeting starts. Well, this was like after 2 in the afternoon, you know. And I said, what time's the meeting start? She said, 7 o'clock. She said, it's 4 blocks away. I walked into my first meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous that day. And let me tell you something. You were the hugginest, kissinest people I had seen in a long time. My judgment kicked in. I said, I bet you they're all living in the same apartment building together, too. Laying in the gutter looking down on other people, you know. And I sat in the back because if any of you were ever going to come over to me, I didn't want you to know who I was. Because if you knew how rotten I was, if you knew my story, you would not allow me in here. You would not allow me in your rooms. I sat by the back door and I thought, if anybody comes towards me, I'll leave. I sat there. And at the end of the meeting, the president of Alcoholics Anonymous, she said, and will our newcomer lead us in the Lord's Prayer of her choice? And I turned around to see what one of your newcomers looked like. And you're all looking at me. I thought, how did they know? And this guy grabs a hold of my hand. And I looked at him. I said, you've got to do that. I said, I don't know how to pray. He says, oh, Kelly, just yell our Father as loud as you can. See what happens. So I stood there. Our Father. And everybody, you know. And then they all, after a moment, joined in. And anyway, none of the women in Downey would sponsor me. I sobered up at a place called the Snake Pit. And then I went downhill from there. And nobody would sponsor me. None of the women wanted to sponsor me in Downey. And I went to the meetings at the Snake Pit. And I was shut down. And there was one man in there. His name was Merle. And Merle talked louder than my head. And I heard Merle. And finally, this one little group of people, the Frankie Kelly group, the Gardendale Camel group, took me in. And she told me, she says, you're going to have to go to work. We all work here. We're all self-supporting through our own contributions. You have to go to work. And at that time, I had no education. I had absolutely nothing. And so anyway, this old guy, this goofy old guy that had taken hold of my hand, he went to the Snake Pit meetings. So I went up to him one day. I said, Steve, what do you do for a living? He says, I'm a real estate broker. I said, really? I thought, if he can be a real estate broker, anybody can. I've since then learned that the 14th step is go to real estate school. Just a joke. Don't take me serious on that. Don't take me serious on any of this. Anyway, so I went to real estate school, and the state of California gave me a real estate license. And I went to work in that city of Downey, power to the powerless. And when I was a year sober, the Downey Board of Realtors made me the chair lady of Make Downey Beautiful Committee. Yeah, and I went to work, let me tell you, I went to work doing real estate, and I'd go to the Snake Pit, and one day I was in the noon meeting. I went to the noon meeting because that's where all the rich guys went. I knew they were rich because they had nice cars. And I was sitting in that meeting one day, and this girl's in there. And she, you know how people give inappropriate, you know, announcements in a meeting, you know. And I'm a good judge of that. And anyway, this girl, she raises her hand. She says, yeah, me and my two children, Bobby and Becky, we're staying in an abandoned car in the parking lot. And at night, there's all kinds of drug deals made and prostitution and that. And we're really scared at night. And we were wondering if anybody had a job for us or anybody had a spare room, anything at all, if somebody could help us. Well, I was sure that those rich guys were going to pass a hat for pass the basket. I'm sure they were going to get her a place to stay or take her home or do something. And after the meeting, they all got up, said the prayer, and walked out. Well, I went running out after them. And I grabbed a hold of them, and I brought them back in the meeting hall, and I threw them up against the wall, you know. I don't know why the women were scared of me. And I said, what are you going to do for her? And this one guy, Merle, right? He looks at me and he says, well, listen, big shot real estate lady. Well, I didn't know I was a big shot real estate lady. I go, what? He says, we have a saying around here in Alcoholics Anonymous. He always given me these sayings, Merle was. And I said, what is it, Merle? And he says, if you see something that needs to be done, do it yourself. And he takes off. I go running out in the parking lot after him, right? And this was before he had his operation. He had to have one of his legs amputated. And when he went to the hospital, they amputated the wrong leg. I know. Anyway, in this day he had both good legs, so I had to run real fast. And I grabbed a hold of him, you know. And he says, look, Kelly, he says, call 923-6565. Ask for Bud McDonald. Tell him your sad A little story. And he turned around, walked away. So I went back in, you know, and I got one of those payphones, and I called Bud McDonald. And somebody answered, and they said, this is the Southeast Council of Alcohol and Drug Programs. I said, I want to speak to Bud McDonald. He was the chairman of the board, by the way. So anyway, he gets on the phone, right? I says, Merle told me to call you and tell you I'm a big shot real estate broker. He laughed. He said, you are, huh? I said, yeah. He says, great, I want to invite you up to our board meeting. I said, when is it? He said, today. And he says, and I'll buy you a gourmet lunch. I said, really? I thought, boy, they really want to hear about how the snake pit's treating people. Boy, I'm going to go up there and tell them, you know. I'm going to go up there and report this place, you know. So I go up there. There's this room with the board of directors sitting around this table. The gourmet lunch was a submarine sandwich and bags of potato chips and Diet Cokes. That was the gourmet lunch. And anyway, I go in and Bud says, you guys, this is Kelly. She's a real estate broker. And they all go, oh. And he goes, everybody that wants Kelly on the board of directors, say aye. And everybody goes, aye, Bud, aye, Bud. And he goes, and nobody say nay. And they all go, oh, no. Great, Kelly, come on in. You're now on the board of directors. I don't know what I'm getting myself into. I just know it's a free lunch, you know. They said, Kelly, we have an idea that's never been tried. Never in the world has this been tried. And they says, and we think that maybe you can help us. I go, what is it? What we want to do, and we've already talked to Judge Emerson, who sentenced me, by the way, Judge Emerson, I love you, Judge Emerson. Anyway, we've already talked to him. We've already got approval on this. What we want to do is we want to put a home together, and it's for women from the streets who have children, where the police aren't going to take their babies away from them and put them into the system, into foster care. I know. What they're going to do is bring that woman and their babies to the house where the women and children can recover together. And we were wondering, would you like to be a part of that? Yes. 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 And so they said, go out and find us a house. And I went out and I found this house. And it was a Spanish home with a wishing well in front. It had 5 bedrooms, 6 bathrooms, 5 two-bedroom bungalows around it. And it had a little shed in the back. And we got that house. And it's called the Foley House. And it's at 11511 Mills Avenue in Whittier, California. And I am so happy I got to be a part of the Foley House. And through that home, we've had hundreds of women and their children come through and change their lives forever. And anyway, I was so happy to be a part of that. Well, they made me the chair lady of the auxiliary committee. Now, being a chair lady is something. You delegate, 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 right? And I had like co-chairs, a lady named Lucretia, her husband John. And they did all the work. These people were like gold. They did all the work. And it got to be Christmas time the first year we were open. We had no money for toys. That's why it was so heartwarming to hear about the toys you're collecting here. We had no money for toys. And Bud told me, he says, Kelly, have a barbecue. Sell $5 tickets. Have people come to the barbecue. We had 18 little children in that home right before our first Christmas. And we collected enough money to buy each little child one toy. He says, now sit down with each child and find out what is that one toy they really want, right? And go shopping. And I got the privilege of going shopping. And I stood at the back of that room, and Bud was dressed up like Santa Claus. And he had this big bag next to him, right? And as each little child went up to see Santa, Santa would look at him and say, and what do you want for Christmas? And that little child would look up at him and tell him, and Santa would reach in a bag and pull that exact toy out and give it to that child. And I saw the light come on in those children's eyes. And then little Joey, he wanted a little red wagon, and he looked around and he knew there was no little red wagon, okay? And he goes up to Santa and he goes, Santa, I really wanted a little red wagon. About that time, the executive director comes out and she opens up her office door, reaches in and pulls this little red wagon, pulls it across that living room, and little Joey just cried in gratitude. And I'm standing back there, big bad woman, right? I'm standing back there crying, and Lucretia puts her arms around me. She says, you're not such a tough old broad now, are you? And I looked at her and I said, you know, Lucretia, anything I'm asked to do in Alcoholics Anonymous, I'm going to do. Because my sponsor had told me that I'm too sick. Maybe the steps aren't even going to work for me. I need to be in service to save my life. I need to be in service. And he was right. And anyway, all that gratitude and all that lasted for about 90 seconds. And anyway, I realized everybody was getting in relationships, and I wasn't allowed to date yet. But I'm in real estate, so I put an ad in the LA Times and said, I had red hair at the time. I go, feisty redhead, looking for a 12-step relationship. And I got these letters, you know, I got them from the mental institutions, and they were letters that said, we know how to do the Texas two-step, but we'd like to invite you over here to teach us the 12-step. I thought, I bet you would. Then I get this one little letter, and it was a letter, and it was a couple lines, and it had, the guy put a glamour shot of himself in the envelope. And it was two little lines. He goes, I'm in a 12-step program too. And I go, wow. And he said, call me if you want. And I called him up. I said, what 12-step program are you in? Uh-huh, you know what's going. He said, I'm an Al-Anon. Manna from heaven! So I had him meet me at Johnny Harris's Bellflower Big Book. And he drove up in this baby blue Cadillac. Yeah, if you know where it's at, Bellflower Big Book, it's all blue collar, okay. He gets out in a three-piece Hickey Freeman suit, hair styled, nails polished, shoots his cuffs as he gets out. I'm standing there watching this. I'm in front of the greeting line, and I fall in love. Well, Mike and I have been married 26 years. And I don't know why, but people in Al-Anon, I don't know why they do, but they call him St. Michael. Totally for reasons unknown to me. So anyway, he gets transferred to Florida. I'm going to go to any lengths to be married. I come to Florida. And you know, Things are good. Everything that has ever been promised to me has been given to me through Alcoholics Anonymous. I'm not wanting for anything. But you know what? At night, like at 2 o'clock in the morning sometimes, I'm thinking of those babies. Were they loved? Have they been taken care of? I don't know where they're at in the world. But my sponsor told me, he said, if you throw yourself into helping other people's children in this program, which you can do better than their families can do, I'm going to guarantee that somebody is taking care of your children to the intensity you're taking care of other people's children. I believed him. And I threw myself into working with others, threw myself into it. And anyway, we come out here, I get into real estate. One day I'm holding an open house in this big mansion over in Vina Del Mar. Has a 42-degree trajectory designer driveway. By then I got a big Cadillac, I got it parked up there. I'm picking up my open house signs, and all of a sudden I hear this big bang, and I look up, and it's my Cadillac coming at me like a freight train. It was like August the 2nd, and there was 135 degrees of heat coming out of that driveway. And anyway, I tried to get out of the way, but I didn't, and it caught my left leg, completely crushed it. Did a tib fib on the right, rolled up my body, pulled my rib cage out of my sternum, crushed my lung. And at that moment, I knew that this was the last conscious thought I was ever going to think, because the tire was going to run over my head. And all of it, in slow motion, my whole life went right in front of me. And I laid there, and I was ready to go, because I knew that I had what the old-timers told me was life beyond my wildest dreams. They were right. And I laid there, and the car ran over my head. The next thing I know, and I'm not going to freak out any newcomers by telling you about the white light and about how I went up to the pearly gates, and I'm not going to tell you about it because I don't want to freak you out, and I'm embarrassed to tell anybody that I got rejected from heaven. I got sent back in an instant. And anyway, I went in and I had surgery done. I did 6.5 weeks up on the physical torture floor, 7th floor of Bayfront. And whenever I got home, I was in a wheelchair. Then I was on a walker, and then I was on crutches. And never call your realtor on her landline. She'll never answer it. Always call her on her cell phone. But that day, whenever I was at home, my landline rang. And it was a girl, and she says, Kelly, we want to invite you out to Los Angeles to speak at Bud McDonald's 50th AA birthday. I said, oh, my God. I says, I can't. I said, I'm a gimp. I can't. She says, Kelly, you used to sponsor me. I knew I was in trouble. She says, I remember when you stood up at the Foley House, and Lucretia and John heard you too, and you said anything you were asked to do in Alcoholics Anonymous, you would do. She says, now get on your computer, get an e-ticket, and tell them you're a gimp, they'll put you in the front of the line. She hung up on me. I never remember being that cruel to her, okay? So I get on the computer, and let me tell you, if you haven't been on the computer for 6.5 weeks, you got a lot of emails. So I'm going on the emails, I'm going, delete. All of a sudden I stop cold, and there's a line item, and it's somebody with my son's birth name. And I click on it, and I open it up. And what it says, is this you? Did I find you? And I emailed him right back. I said, yeah, you found me. And I wanted him to know that I'm a good woman today. I said, I want you to know I'm almost 20 years sober in the program of Alcoholics Anonymous. He emailed me right back and he says, I want you to know I'm almost 6 months sober in the program of Alcoholics Anonymous. So anyway, I said, well, I don't know if you want anything to do with me, because I'm a very pushy person. And whenever I was sponsoring people, I'd tell them when they got their families together, now back off. So I'm telling myself the same thing I tell my sponsors, back off. I says, well, I don't know if you might want to, you know, have a relationship with me or not, but I got to fly out to L.A. and I won't be back for about a week. He emails me back and he says, well, while you're out in L.A., after you speak at that old-timers meeting, get in your car, your rental car, and come down to the Newport Beach Alano Club. I'll be waiting for you. I drive down Newport Boulevard, right? I come to 32nd Street on the corner. There's this hyper kid walking back and forth, back and forth. Oh, that's my boy! I leap out of the car best I could with a walker, you know. I put my arms around him. I haven't let go yet. And we went and had a talk that day. And he says, look, I'd like to have a relationship going forward with you, but I want to make happy memories with you. He says, but here's the thing. Your daughter loathes you. And if you think you're going to have a relationship with me to get to her, it's we're ending it right now. I said, oh, Tim, no, I'll take what I can get. He says, great. So I had to go back to Florida, and I'm on the 405. And my cell phone rings. And in those days, I could answer it. Now you can't. You have to be hands-free, but I could answer it. And I answered the phone, and it's a young lady. She says, is this Terry? Nobody had called me Terry in a long time. I knew it was in trouble. I said, yes, it is. She said, this is your daughter, Tracy, and I understand you're in town, and before you go back, we need to talk, and I want to meet in a neutral place. I go, okay. She told me where to meet her, and I called my sponsor. He says, you go with your hat in your hand. You got 2 ears. You listen. You don't talk. She's been the one that's been harmed. You go and listen. So I meet her. And for 5.5 hours, Tracy and I pull the walls down between us. And I left out of there. I was so emotional. I was so emotional. And I get back in my car. And all of a sudden, I thought I didn't ask her, did she want to stay in contact with me? But through modern technology, I had her cell phone number, you know, in my phone. So I pushed the button. She answered right away. I said, Tracy, I don't know if you want my contact information. She said, I'm so glad you called. She said, before you go back to Florida, would you like to meet your grandbabies? Yes! 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 Yes, I would. I met Blake and Warren. I met my little grandchildren. And my daughter says to me, oh, and they stole my heart. They stole my heart. My daughter says to me, I've got to ask you something. What she had been doing is she had been going to church, and she has an eating disorder. It's called anorexia nervosa. And she says that the reason they told her she had it was because everybody told her that she reminded them of her mother, of me, and that she couldn't take nourishment, that she would reject the nourishment right away. And she was going to this church. It's called it's in Orange County, Saddleback Church. I'd never heard of it, Saddleback Church, okay? And some guy named Rick or something like that, oh, really? Okay. Good. Anyway, he had suggested that she go to this weekend seminar. And so her friends took her and they put her up in front. And this couple got up to take him through this weekend seminar. This couple, right, got up to take him through this weekend seminar. And they said, well, this is a weekend seminar on forgiveness. And we would like to show you how this works. Do we have a volunteer? Well, her friends push her up on stage. And they sit her down in a chair. And so the lady says, this is how it's going to work. She says, who are you resentful at? She says, my birth mother, she abandoned me. I'm a mother. I can't understand how a mother can abandon her children. What kind of a human being is that? And then a lady looked at her. She says, look, you never have to contact your birth mother. You never have to have anything to do with her. This is you cleaning up your side of the street. This is you taking responsibility to take care of you. You never have to have anything ever to do with her. What's your birth mother's name? She said, Teresa Kelly. And the lady turned to her and she goes, Teresa Kelly from Downey, California? My daughter goes, yeah. She goes, in your case, you need to get a hold of your birth mother. loved ones. That was Lucretia and John, the couple that was up there from the Foley House. Yeah. And anyway, my daughter looked at me and she said to me, I just have one question for you. I'm winding this down. We're going to be closing now. I just have one question for you. I thought, oh, anything. God, if she wants $1 million, I'm going to have to sell a few more houses. But whatever it is, yeah. She says, will you forgive me? I go, forgive you? She said, please forgive me. Forgive me for loathing you and hating you and bad-mouthing you all these years. Please forgive me. I said, oh, my darling daughter, I forgive you. In fact, I believe, I forgive everybody. I forgive people from the past. I forgive people far away, near. Anybody who's going to screw over me in the future, you're already forgiven. I forgive. Anyway, my grandchildren love me. They've never seen me drunk. They've all never seen my character defects. They call me Grandma ATM. Please don't judge me. I got to do what I got to do, okay? Not all my character defects have been chiseled out of me. Last year, they were having a big family reunion at my daughter's house. And I was invited, and the Catholics came, me and my husband came, my two stepsons came, the Pentecostals came, and we all love each other, and we were all there as one big, extended, loving family. Where else can this happen but an Alcoholics Anonymous? Thank you.